Hey guys, Janus here. Today's video will be all about peripheral vascular resistance and its somewhat paradoxical findings. In the past, I have held firmly to the belief that elevations in blood pressure were a destructive force that would ultimately lead to the downturn of a tissue mass's health. This belief stemmed primarily from a massive oversight in the medical community that I've only recently come to fully understand. In modern medicine, doctors are fully convinced for most that the heart is a pump when in fact it is not. Because of this erroneous belief, modern medicine is convinced that high blood pressure causes peripheral vascular resistance when in reality it is peripheral vascular resistance itself that causes elevations in pressure. Blood is not forced into the periphery by the seemingly mighty beats of the heart. Instead, it is pulled by the very tissues themselves. The heart beats in a passive manner, or perhaps a better way to say it would be in a magnifying manner, almost like a slingshot. As the heart is opening and closing its chambers, the tissues are still pulling blood into them. Now imagine for a moment, instead of, say, pulling a bow back here and then letting go and then firing an arrow, obviously it's not going to go very far and it's going to fall. Now imagine drawing that bow back to its fullest potential and then letting that arrow fly. Well, that's essentially what the heart does. And the way that you can tell that this is what happens is by looking at how the heart beats, how the heart moves, how it behaves. And the biggest telltale sign comes in the aortic arch. See, if blood were being forced from the heart in a pressure manner, if its contraction was forcing blood into the system of the body, we would see the aortic arch unbend. We would see it. But instead, we actually see this. It actually bends in instead of going out. In, not out, which means that the blood, obviously, is, like I said, being drawn into our periphery. So what the heart does is it lets that pressure build on the other side. It lets that suction build and then releases. It's kind of neat. If you'd like to know more about this, I highly recommend looking into the work of Dr. Thomas Cowen. And he wrote a book called Cosmic Heart, Human Heart. Really great read and opened my eyes to all of this, and it's really become kind of like a centerpiece to the discussion of PE for a lot of reasons, which I'm going to be going into later in this video. Okay, so I can say all that, you know, that the heart really has blood sucked from it. I can say that, sure, but explaining it, really showing how the magic trick works, God, oh man, oh shit, that is just, And you know what's really funny, guys? I've talked about the key mechanism behind all of this working before. Can anybody guess what it was? It's that special lining that's inside all of our blood vessels, which, by the way, is why the angion method works so well. If you haven't guessed what it is, I'll go ahead and tell you. It's the glycocalyx. The glycocalyx, as we know, is a gel-like coating on the inside of our blood vessels. You could almost think of it like jello that has little sensors, little hairs embedded in it that helps blood vessels not only sense the flow of blood, but even more cool than that, even cooler, is it acts just like a maglev, just like a hyper train, you know, that train that's over in Japan, the one that goes super duper fast. It's beautiful. The only way I'm really going to be able to show this is with a picture, so give me a second. Okay, guys, behind me here, I have drawn a capillary. These would be our endothelial cells, okay? This green lining would be the glycocalyx, and these black lines here would be the hairs that the endothelial cells use to sense shear stress. All right, now as we know, our body is comprised primarily of capillary beds, not big, you know, robust, you know, arteries or veins or stuff like that. I mean, they're there for transporting the blood to the various different portions of the body, but primarily our body's made of capillary beds. So, how exactly does this magic trick work? You know, showing it. Here we go. Okay, guys, to understand this magic trick, and it's still going to be really difficult to explain, so just bear with me, we have to go through three parts. All right, three parts. And it starts with the shape of water itself. Here is a water molecule. All right. We have two hydrogens, 2-1 oxygen, and because of the interplay between these three atoms, we end up with a negative side on the oxygen side and a positive side on the hydrogen side. And once again, because of the way they arrange themselves, we form a pyramid. Now, whenever water is all by itself, say in this glass, for instance, it will form weak bonds and chains, like I've drawn here, known as hydrogen bonds. The positive side will face towards the negative side of the other water molecule and form these loose, undulating chains that will break, and reform. And it is because of this property that, say, whenever you put water in a glass and you fill it all the way up, it will form this parabola right here. It's because of that water tension, it's because of those hydrogen bonds, that this is even possible. Now, this is where everything becomes a little complicated. Whenever you take water and it becomes absorbed into something, a spongy-like material, such as the glycocalyx that lines the inside of our blood vessels, the charges align themselves in one direction. In this case, the positive end of the water molecule faces the endothelial cells, and the negative portion faces the inside of the capillary channel. Now, what happens next is just amazing. It's a spiral. I've talked about how blood spirals through our blood vessels, and it's all because of this pyramid shape. I'll try to explain the best I can. As water passes through a channel such as this, a blood vessel that's constructed in this manner, a capillary, that has the glycocalyx lining, that has the charges aligned in one direction, the water molecule will spiral, attach, break apart, spiral, attach, break apart, spiral, attach, break apart, and it will continue to do that down the length of this tube. This would technically be considered what is called a protonated tube. Capillaries are protonated tubes. And as it spirals down this blood vessel, this capillary, it is pulling blood into it, into the capillary. So on this side, we would have, you know, the upper portions of the arteries, the heart side, and this would be the, you know, dense capillary side. So heart organs, heart organs, okay? Travels this way. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why the heart is not a pump. It's amazing. I'm a little humbled by it, to be honest. It's really cool. But at the exact same time, it's also a little weird because in no small way, we have a great deal in common with the common houseplant. We grow in a manner almost identical to a houseplant. Okay, just to state one more time, the heart is not a pump. Your blood circulates through your body. Right now, it's circulating through your body because of the properties of water. Heart, not a pump. More like a, like I said, more like a slingshot at best, a slingshot. I would classify it as a slingshot, as a force multiplier. Yes. Now, given that, like I said, we have a lot in common with that oh-so-lovable houseplant, pressure takes on a whole new meaning. What this means is that, in actuality, pressure is an important force for causing tissue growth, and I've linked some awesome videos in the description box that demonstrate this concept beautifully in pumpkins. It's really, really cool. I seriously highly recommend watching that video. Here at the end, though, I would make an important caveat. It should be stated that instances of high blood pressure are inherently damaging, but not nearly in the manner that, we've been told or been led to believe. The best comparison I could draw between, the way blood moves through our vascular system and how it, interacts with our organs and, how it works with a plant would be like muscle tissue and weightlifting. We pick up a weight, rep out with it, our muscles experience microtrauma, our body repairs itself with a symphony of chemical and hormonal signaling using elements obtained from our diet, and if both sides of that reparative process are adequate, as in we are intaking enough food, we're getting enough food in our diet, and our hormonal profile is on par, we end up with a net increase in tissue mass. One of the real problems with a lot of the hypertensive studies that are done today centers around the populations or age groups are being conducted on. Many times these are men and women that are either, eating a real shit diet and suffering the consequences of doing that, or they're suffering from the consequences of aging. To simplify it even more, they're either eating like shit or they have a shit hormonal profile. But you don't hear blood pressure anywhere in that equation. And it really shouldn't be. Like I said, blood pressure is needed to cause growth. But if you're, eating like shit, peripheral aspects of your vascular system, they contract, force blood into the main channels, blood pressure skyrockets, and, what do they say? It's like, blood pressure must cause all of this. It's not the fucking cheeseburger you just shoved in your face 10 minutes ago. Fuck that. It's not real. Whatever. Or at the exact same time, it's, no, your hormonal profile looks great. Your estrogen levels are through the roof, your testosterone's in the tank, but hey, you look like the rest of the population, so fuck it. Who cares? And that's literally the scope of it, guys. These hypertensive studies are either being conducted on people that already are just, in the tank, either in their diet or in, their age. They're suffering from poor lifestyle choices, or they're just suffering from the effects of time. What I'm trying to say is that blood pressure is an innocent bystander of those two very real realities. And, like I've covered in past videos, if you want to gain, eat more food, and, to gain optimally, to gain, as fast as possible, you have to eat optimally. You have to eat clean, get the bad shit out. And the other side of that coin, like I just got done talking about, improve your hormonal profile. Eat good food, good hormonal profile, net tissue gain. Well, guys, that's it for this week's video. I hope everybody enjoyed it because I will be building on these concepts in future videos. I will see everyone hopefully next Sunday. My schedule has been a little crazy. And lastly, as always, I'm your host, Janus, signing off.